One of the great things about genetic genealogy is it allows us to use this DNA record to help identify people that may not be apparent in any of the paper records that we're normally used to with genealogy. I had a question from a viewer about how to use DNA to figure out their biofather's side of the family. Howdy, welcome to Family History Fanatics, where we love helping you climb your family tree and have fun along the way. If you're new to genetic genealogy, chances are you have lots of questions. Be sure to check out the link in the description below that contains our free guide to the 5 most common DNA questions we are asked. Now, this has been covered in various ways in other videos, but I wanted to give a little simplified one because I'm going to make an assumption based on their question. And that assumption is that they knew who their biological mother is, and they also have DNA from their biological mother. If they have this, then really the process is much more simplified because we have half of the puzzle solved. So step one is we want to identify the not shared matches with your mother. In other words, we're going to compare your matches to your mother's matches, and we're going to look at the matches that you have that your mother doesn't have. Because you got your DNA from your mother and your father, any matches that you have that your mother doesn't have to be from your father's side. Family tree DNA makes this easy. When you're looking at your match list, you can click on the little person icon and there's an in common with and a not in common with. You want the not in common with to figure out which matches you don't share with your mother. On GEDmatch, if you're using the people who match both kits or one of two kits, you're going to use the middle tab in order to see which kits match you, the child, but not your mother. And those are going to be the kits that are part of your father's side of the family. Now, unfortunately, with 23andMe and Ancestry and MyHeritage, they don't have an easy does not match function. So what you need to do is you actually need to make a list of your matches and probably just, you know, your top 50 to 100 matches on your mom's side and see which of them are on your side and basically cross those off. And the ones that are left are going to be on your dad's side. We want to take this list of matches and we want to start to group them into clusters. Now, one way to do this is with the Leeds method. And if you don't have your mom's DNA, then you can do this anyway and actually just start at step number 2. Now the goal of the Leeds method is to separate out your matches into 4 groups representing your 4 grandparents. It doesn't always separate out that easy. As you can see on this chart here, I actually have 6 colors represented as opposed to 4 colors. Sometimes you might only get 3 colors represented, but that's what the goal is. And the goal then is to identify which of these colors correspond to which grandparent. So in the case of knowing who your mother is, if you can identify which groups belong to your mother's side, then the other groups belong to your father's side. And you now have a couple of clusters of matches that you know belong on your father's side. Step 3, once you have created some cluster, is you want to identify a common ancestor among that group of people. And this may be, you know, 5 to 10 different matches that you can go through their trees on Ancestry or MyHeritage. You can email them to ask about who their grandparents were and build your own tree to help see how they might intersect. Depending on how much DNA they share with you, they may be 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th cousins. So you might be looking at 3rd or 4th great grandparents as far as a common ancestor among this group of people. But once you have identified a common ancestor among this group of people, well, then you can go on to step 4, which is to now start do descendancy research of that common ancestor, find out who all their children, all their grandchildren, all their great grandchildren are, to the point where you now can start looking for which of these people are potential biological fathers for you. In other words, they have to be in the right time and place. And once you have that list of potentials, well, now you actually need to research those people more in depth and really try to pinpoint where they were about 9 to 10 months before you were born. Because prior to 1976, the mother and the father had to be in the same place at the same time for there to be a child 9 to 10 months later. So if you can pinpoint where that father was 9 to 10 months and your mother was in the same place, and that is a very good candidate for who your biological father is. From there, you may want to be now reaching out to family members of that, close family members of that, to have them test and see whether or not you have that confirmation. So with this fifth step, you are really isolating your list of potentials down to hopefully just a couple, and ideally one family that might have a set of boys that are the potential father that you're looking for. If you want some more detail, I have videos about the DNA adoption website. I think it's a series of three videos that goes through a more in-depth process of finding your adoptive parents. Like I mentioned for this, I assume that since you were just asking about your bio father and hopefully have DNA from your biological mother, that is a big step because it is going to eliminate a lot of the potential paths you can go down, and you can really focus in on just those matches who belong on your father's side. I've put the first of that series of videos at the top here that you can learn more about the process of finding unknown parents. But if you want to learn something else about DNA, then try the video down below and hopefully have DNA from that.